Ricardo Campa from the Grand University of Krakow. He's Italian and works at the Institute for Sociology. He's in Poland since a couple of years. He speaks Polish, Italian, English, and French, but not German. He's the founder and president of the Associazione Italiana Transumanisti, and since 2010 he has served as the vice president of the scientific committee of the Philomathia Association in Italy. And he's a member of the Institute for Ethics and Emerging Technologies at Hartford in Connecticut. And he works with Arthur together. He's a collaborator of the History of Ideas Research Center and an author of a couple of books. And he writes in Polish, Italian, and English. And now he will talk about game theory, and it will be a special case of game theory. This ultimate game. Yeah. The floor is yours.
Okay, so.
Yeah, you can start.
I can start. So, as you can see, the title is The Ultimatum Game, Cooperation Competition in the Light of Neuroscience. I hope my lecture is in context, because I don't know what was the topic of your presentation. And the last presentation, I just understood one word, it was tombola. This is recognized. But I think that there are connections between game studies in general and game theory. We may also say that game theory is a part of game studies. My approach is historical, because this is history of ideas. So at the very beginning, I show you the contents of my presentation. I will talk about game theory and game studies, and I will trace a brief history of game theory. This part will be probably boring for those that are already acquainted with game theory, but I know that not all of you are into game theory, so I think it will be interesting to start from this brief history to put you in context and to understand then why this ultimatum game was framed or elaborated. It's interesting because it's hard to find a word, because you can't say it was invented, because it's not art. It was not discovered, because it's not empirical science, strict to say so. It is a model. It's a model that helped to understand reality. All these games are models that help to understand reality, but they are a bit artificial in the formulation. So we can say elaborated or framed. Then we will see the debate very shortly about ultimatum game, because there are, of course, some philosophical consequences, but we'll be very brief. And then a further progress in research is when neuroscientists and biologists started being interested in this, because they wanted to understand what was the reason for certain decisions. And after, we will see all the developments of this, because there are more and more experiments about this. A way to define game theory is also, to call game theory is interactive decision theory, is another way. So it is in the wake of rational choice theory or rational decision theory. And it comes from mathematics, but then it was applied to social sciences. So this is the very beginning. Game theory and game studies developed rather independently, because game studies were developed mostly in cultural studies or history or philosophy, and while game theory comes from mathematics, as I said. But both approaches are interdisciplinary, and so they are open to contamination, and they met inside social sciences, political sciences, or social science, or sociology, or economics. I quote here a sentence by Clifford Geertz, who's an anthropologist, and you can say that he quotes all these possible game analogy in the same sentence. I mean, and he wrote a book, the title was Local Knowledge, 1983, and then he said that this game analogy is increasingly popular in contemporary social theory. It needs, of course, critical examination. And there is this tendency to see one or another sort of social behavior as one or another sort of game. It's very hard to define game in this context, because generally, for common sense, a game is something that has no serious consequences. It's something we do to have fun. While if you have some serious consequences, then is no more a game. But this is not what happened in game theory. Because game theory or the problem are very serious, where people may die or survive. But we find this in history, of course. If you think about gladiators, it was a game, but they were killing each other. If you think about extreme sports today, people may die with this. If you think about casino, if you think about the stock market is like a casino. They're gamblers, but people may die because they may lose all their money. And also, normal games. If you play poker, you may destroy your life. So I think it's much more subjective if we call it game or not. It's hard to find an objective definition of this. Here is another sentence by Clifford Geertz. The most important are Wittgenstein's conception of form of life as language games, using a ludic view of culture, and then the new strategics of von Neumann and Morgenstern's theory of game and economic behavior. And I'm talking about this third approach, while you were probably talking about the other two, as I understood from the title of the presentation, not from the comment. But you can see that all of these were somehow having a role in social sciences. Here we have Richard Svedberg. Sometimes I don't pronounce correctly this name from Nordic countries. I'm sorry for this. And I don't know German. He said, how can we recognize where it's from, this influence? Well, if we're talking about payoffs, strategy, and matrix, then it's game theory. It's not game style. It's not Wittgenstein or Huizinga. It's rather phenomenal. So now a brief history, just to put you in context. This is an important date, because you notice that Clifford Geertz mentioned von Neumann. Von Neumann wrote his first article on game theory in 1928. This is von Neumann, and the title of the article, sorry for my pronunciation, is Zur Theorie des Gesellschaftsspiels. Is it really the beginning of game theory? Of course it's not. But von Neumann, after translated these works in English, and that's why for English-speaking people it started from him. But if they, we know that it started before, and especially French mathematicians were very much involved in this. If you think about Blaise Pascal and De Fermat, they were already developing some mathematical model to understand games. And Émile Borel, he also invented the name, but of course in French, Théorie des Jeux. Mm-hmm. When this article was translated into French, it was translated as Sur la Théorie des Jeux. So we were using the same name. But for Americans, of course, this is the date, because for them, if something is not printed in English, it does not exist. So it's 1944, because, and the second reason is when von Neumann, together with Oscar Morgenstern, who was an economist, they published this book, which is the core, I mean the very beginning, from a theory of games and economic behavior. The second reason, of course, is not just because in English is in English, it's because it talks about economics. So it started getting very, very concrete for them, because we know that Americans are very pragmatists and they are very much interested in money. I don't know why, but this is the case. And so that's why game theory entered the American debate, and they were very good in developing. In fact, they are much more into this than continental Europeans. Another important date is 1950, because in that day, probably the most famous game inside game theory, the Prisoner's Dilemma, everybody heard at least about this name at least once, was formulated inside the Rand Corporation by Mary Flood and Melvin Drescher. But what is the Rand Corporation? It was field of operation that was dealing with decisions and especially with military strategy. So they were much interested in strategies of during the Cold War. And this is the second interest of Americans, is money and power. So this is about military strategies. And actually the two prisoners here are USSR and USA. In a sense, they are both prisoners because they are dealing with each other, but they cannot make the most rational choice, really, because they are inside the frame. Well, I tell you very briefly, but I know most of you know about this. If you have two people in jail, two prisoners, if they both confess, if we say, yes, we did commit together this crime, then they both get 5 years. If one keep quiet and the other confess, the one that keep quiet get 10 years and the other go free. But if they both keep quiet, they just get 1 year jail. And so this would be the most rational choice, just collaborating tacitly. But this is not what they generally don't do. They will both confess, and so they get 5 years. So the whole thing is about this, is that they don't take the most rational decision for this reason. And as you can see, it's a canonical example of a game. This is a non-cooperative games. In game theory, we distinguish between cooperative games and non-cooperative. This is non-cooperative because they cannot negotiate, they cannot talk to each other. And so very often we have this situation in business or in war, but also in everyday life, interaction between individuals, because you can apply game theory also to love or other situations like that, not necessarily to war or business. This is a book published by Melvin Drescher, Games of Strategy, Theory and Application. It's a classic, it's published to today but with a different title, The Mathematics of Games of Strategy. Now it's the new title. He made clear that it's mathematics. At the beginning there was no such word there. 1951. Why this date is important? Because we have a mathematician, quite famous, John Nash, that published an article entitled Non-Cooperative Games. And he defines very well the concept of Nash equilibrium. If you saw this famous movie, Beautiful Mind, it's him. So he was affected by a form of schizophrenia, but he was helping the development of this Nash equilibrium. I will skip all the technical parts about Nash equilibrium now, because I don't have time. This is planned for 1 hour presentation. I have 40 minutes, 30, 40 minutes. So I'll just tell you that this Nash equilibrium was, of course, already present in previous theories. But they were just analyzing zero-sum game. Zero-sum game is when one player win, the other lose. There's no situation, a win-win situation, when both collaborate to win. And what Nash does is that he makes this rule general. But I will just tell you one sentence just to make you understand what is the Nash equilibrium, for those that, of course, are not into this matter. We may say that when two or more players have strategies in their mind, they have strategies, and they figure out more or less what is the strategy of other players, when they don't have any interest to change their own strategy because the situation can go only worse, this is the Nash equilibrium. So they will not change because they cannot improve it. So I skip this because I don't have time, because for me the most important part comes later when we talk about neuroscience. 1957, we have another important date because here we have two authors, Duncan Lewis and Howard Reifel at Columbia University, that published a book, Games and Decision, which was very popular for social scientists, for political scientists, for sociologists. Why? Because it's easy. It's easy to understand because it's non-technical. And so if anyone wants to start from this, to study game theory, probably should start from this book. Of course, there are maybe others written now, but this was successful for this reason. So you have two person zero-sum game, two person non-zero-sum games, and person games, individual group decision, and so on. I could tell you more about the history because they were working with Paul Lazarsfeld and Robert K. Merton, which is a key figure in sociology. Robert K. Merton was never much interested in this, but Paul Lazarsfeld was interested in mathematics applied to sociology. Now, 1964, why? Because Michel Crozier is a French sociologist. He wrote a classic in sociology, the bureaucratic phenomenon, the phenomenon bureaucratic, I think this was the title, and he was using game theory. So he was one of the first sociologists using game theory, And another, I don't have it here, but there was another French sociologist using game theory, quite famous, Raymond Blanc. Mm-hmm. He wrote a book, La Place du Désordre. So in French, it was not only developed from this, the Fermat and so on, but it was also popular among sociologists. 1970, why? First, game theories win a Nobel Prize, Paul Samuelson. 2 years later, Kenneth Harrow win the Nobel Prize. Altogether, there are 12 scholars that won the Nobel Prize in game theory. So it seems to be a very fruitful field of analysis, at least very much respected in Stockholm, because they keep winning Nobel Prizes. And then I think it's much more difficult to win a Nobel Prize in game studies. Or, but philosophers can still win in literature, as you can win at a Sartre. But in this field, you must deal with numbers if you want to win a Nobel Prize. Then ultimatum game, finally we start talking about this. This was developed by Germans, and it was very successful. 1982, I cannot pronounce this name, I'm sorry. Werner Guth, Rolf Schmidberger, Bernd Schwarzer, more or less. Okay, so this is a very simple game, and that's why it was successful, because it was easy to make experiments about this, but it is really brilliant as an idea. It's a zero-sum game with no cooperation, no cooperative. So you have two people there, and you give a sum of money to one of them, and they have to divide this sum, this money, according to certain rules. Let me show you. This is called extensive form representation. It's very simple. You can see you have one player, player one, that he can offer a fair or unfair proposal to player two. Player two can accept or reject. So his 5-5 is 50-50, it means it's fair. And so if he accepts, they should share this money. If he doesn't accept, it's 0-0. They both go home with no money. So the experiments are made with real money, because it must be real. So they really waste this money. And the other unfair is 8-2. I keep 8 for myself, I give 2 to you. If you accept, we share, if not, we lose everything. So this is, in literary form now, the money is given to one player. He, she makes the offer by proposing how to divide the sum of money. Then the second player can either accept or reject the proposal. If the second player accepts, the money is split according to the proposal. If she rejects, neither player receives anything, and they play with real money. Of course, you must find a university that gives you this money to make this experiment. I don't think that like, you know, university the people in the street. The Americans have this money. Non-cooperative, I already told you about this. I skipped it because I want to talk more about welcome later. I also skipped this part. This is a formal representation, semi-formal representation, in order to decide which is the Nash equilibrium in this game. I skip it, but I tell you that there is a second game equilibrium here, Nash equilibrium, that can be more than one. One is this, is the simple word, is when player two would reject all proposals in which player one received more than P. What does it mean? It means that player one understands at a point which is the level under which player two will reject. Let's say they understand that if he gives six for me and four for you, he will accept it. If he understand that I go up to seven for me and three, he would lose it. So the Nash equilibrium is six. Even six, four, six, four. You cannot change it. Both players cannot change it. That's why it's an equilibrium. But there is a second one, is when player two doesn't accept any sum of money less than everything. He would reject everything, he wants everything. So player one has to offer the full sum. It's $10, $20, or $40. This is another Nash equilibrium, because they cannot get out from this situation. They will always lose, both of them, because player one would never offer nothing for himself. But this is mathematically, it is a Nash equilibrium. Of course, there was another famous mathematician, Reinhold, something that he decided, he formulated a way to decide which Nash equilibrium is credible and which is not. This is not credible. But this is exactly, in fact, in history we had this. If you think about Marxism, is second player two, I mean workers, and we want everything. We don't want to share with, no. So it may happen in history, this situation. This is Marx theory. But the thing is, according to something was not credible, and he won the Nobel Prize for making better this natural equilibrium. But this experiment by this German social scientist, they defined themselves social scientists, not mathematicians. It was published in the Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization in 1982. What were the expected results? We know that neoclassical economics, and classical economics as well, is based on this idea of homo economicus. The thing that an agent attempts to maximize utility as a consumer and economic profit as a producer. If this is true, and this is the main postulate of classical economics, player two should accept any sum of money, whatever. We know that this is rooted in history. John Stuart Mill, he proposed this definition. He said that this is an arbitrary definition of man. Probably Marx would say is a definition of bourgeois and not of man, in the sense that, you know, this is rooted in liberal economy, in liberal philosophy. In fact, John Stuart Mill defined also an agent as a rational agent, as someone who is capable of judging the comparative efficacy of means for obtaining an end. So it is a specific form of rationality. Heidegger was also criticizing, you know, this type of rationality. Yes? So it's not only Marx, we have it also from Heidegger. But this is the definition of is the cornerstone of rational choice theory. And Americans really like this, and English as well. It's in the Anglo-Saxon world. So it's interesting because if we define utility as monetary gain, then a statement like humans always try to maximize utilities is empirically testable. And the ultimate game is a test, is a good test for this, because we can anticipate the player two will accept any offer. Because $1 is more than zero, so why say no and wasting this money, even if the other guy gets 10 or 12 or 40 and so on. But the empirical results, of course, are different. First of all, player one tends to offer 50-50. Tends to be fair. And secondly, when it's not fair, player two rejects it systematically. So here you see the graphic, you see that here they are playing with $20. So if it's 10-10, it's okay, then 11-9 is okay, 12-8 is still okay, but then it starts going down. And when you offer like 19-1, is almost zero people accepting this, or 18-2. So what's going on here? Oh, this picture right here is almost universal. They tried it everywhere, all around the world. At least in industrial countries, at least. They tried it in Japan, as in Europe or in America. So it's always like this. Mostly fair offers, 50-50, and when it's less than 20%, it's rejected. It means, apparently, the neoclassic economics postulates are refuted by this empirical test. I mean, they are false. So economics does not exist. Because there is something that takes place here, which is, we can call it ethics, intended as a sense of justice. And people may have interest not only maximizing material monetary utility, but reinforcing it as ethical standards. Of course, we may open a discussion about ethics here, but I think it's pretty clear what I mean. Sense of justice. I already mentioned this because in sociology this was very interesting because, you know, sociology deal with this idea of honor, of injustice, and so on. But as I was mentioning Marx, if you think all the discussion about surplus value is how we should divide this profit that the company makes. For Marx, of course, everything had to go to the workers, and there shouldn't be any capitalists. But otherly, Baudon was discussing that even capitalists are working, because they are having strategies also, but it's about this. And now, debate. Some 1989, we have, for instance, this article, an experimental study of sequential bargaining by Hawks and Roth, and they try to defend the paradigm of the homo economicus, because they say that anyway, player two is maximizing his utility anyway, even if when he refused. But they just say you cannot translate utility into money. So if you define it in a different way, in fact, as I write here, if you consider self-esteem, sense of justice as a utility, the behavior is rational because the player too is somehow getting some psychological benefit for punishing this person is too egoist in his eyes, so he's getting some benefit from a psychological point of view, or he may be have a psychological harm from accepting the low offer. Then he feels bad because he was like, he feels he was cheated by the other one. Mario Bunge, he said, well, if we define utility this way, then we just have a tautology, because if we say that rational businessmen always try to maximize gain, and is rational the player that maximize utility, then this is just a tautology. Either we say something concrete, like monetary gain, or it's not empirically testable. And now, okay, here I was trying to give a different interpretation to save this, just for the sake of discussion, save this paradigm of home economics, because someone, player two may think, okay, I will have, this is an investment, I will have future gains by punishing egoists. We put them, we marginalize them, and then the environment is safer, the social environment, so I will make more money in the future. But of course, we don't have evidence that this calculus takes place in mind of player two. And the interesting thing is try to get inside the brain of these players. 1994, important date, because John Hassan, John Nash, Reynald Selten, I was mentioning them before, they got the Nobel Prize. For the first time, game theory is measuring the motivation for their pioneer analyzing of equilibria in the theory of non-cooperative games. Why this is a turning point? Because then biologists and neuroscientists, they think that this is a serious field of inquiry, so they started being involved, not just sociologists or mathematicians or politologists, but also biologists and neuroscientists. And they started making their own experiments. And here we have ultimate game in the light of neuroscience. Next phase, 2003. Here we have a very important work published by Alan Sanford. Generally, they are all teams. So mathematicians, psychologists, neurologists working together. And he published this article on science. So we see that we're moving from social science to natural sciences here. He makes, again, very briefly, he makes this experiment again, the ultimate game, because he thinks, this is the assumption, that we shouldn't think only in terms of rational decision. Emotions play a role. These emotions didn't have any part in those postulates of rational choice theory. We should take into account of emotions. So let's check it with this machine, magnetic resonance imaging, MRI, functional magnetic resonance imaging. So we get our 19 participants, players, we check what happened in their brain when they get these offers by player one. The rules of the games were these, that we have 10 humans playing player one and 10 computers. So, anyway, humans, they were not just asking random, they were following an algorithm. So they were just proposing the same amount of money that were proposed by the computer. But the same player was playing with humans and was playing with computers. Then, of course, there was another computer making controls, but I don't get into detail here. They get $10 and they start playing. And the rules are the same. So you see, so the both humans and computers offer a fair offer, 50-50, for 50% of the offer, and 50% were unfair. This was the rule. What happened? These are the results. It confirmed once again that people refuse low offer and accept fair offer. But first interesting aspect. Apparently we are ready to accept a low offer from a computer but not from a human being. And that's why bankers steal our money in bank. Because you know, if someone gets close to you and gets 5 euros from your pocket, you get very angry. But when you go to your bank account, you see that they take 5 euros and you don't understand why you don't protest. It's a computer, it's a machine. So this is a very interesting consequences, I think. And look at this picture. Three parts of the brain are activated when we have an unfair offer. So bilateral anterior insula is the first, dorsolateral prefrontal cortex is the second, and anterior cingulate cortex. So let's see what are the functions of these three. When the offer was fair, just one of these three parts of our brain were active, it was the second one, the dorsolateral prefrontal cortex. When they was unfair, all of three of these. So the bilateral anterior insula activates when we have negative emotional stress states. Negative emotional stress. This can be distress, hunger, but also disgust. Disgust. This insula activate with this feeling of disgust. When we see for someone vomiting, when we see a very ugly insect or animal, well, this animal may think that we are ugly, but it doesn't matter. When we see, when we can smell very bad smell or things like that, we have this feeling of disgust, these neural networks activate. But this neural network activate also when we meet a very egoist person. It's the same part of the brain. That's very interesting. Because it reacts to both physical and moral disgust. Not just physical, it's moral disgust. So we must be careful. Don't play too egoist with people, because people will have this very bad reaction in their brain, and this is almost automatic. What about the second one? The dorsolateral prefrontal cortex activates when we have the feeling that we have to take a decision to gain something, some money. This is the rational choice theory. Economists were just thinking we have just this, but we don't have just this. Yes, this is when we can see a possibility to maximize our profit. This part of the brain activates, reflects the emotional response to the offer. So this always activates, because even $1, money, and then activate the other one. And what about the third one? The third one is the anterior cingulate cortex that activates when we have a conflict. So the third one activates because it recognizes a conflict in the brain. A partner says, get this money, then what? Don't get it. You know, it's like punishing. So we have a conflict. For the development of neuroeconomics, because now we know what? That the majority of people behave this way. But we still don't know why some people don't, because we still have some people that accept this low amount of money. So the question is, why this happened? Of course, this is not mathematics. Your real life is much more chaotic and complicated, but let's try to see if we have an answer. In 2007, in fact, we have three researchers, Zach Stanton and Hamadi, that said, well, if we do this game, we change the roles of people. Sometimes they play as player one, sometimes they play as player two. We enhance their empathy because they understand that they are in different positions. It's the same if you take policemen and people demonstrating. If you change their role, probably they will stop beating each other because they understand, you know, from a different perspective thing. But since they are always in this role, they keep beating each other. So this was one way. And the other thing is like enhancing empathy in a different way, with intranasal oxytocin, with a spray. You put this spray in the nose of people, you enhance this oxytocin, and then what happened? Happens that it increased Jagasos offers 80%. So do you want to have to deal with some of the business? Just put this spray in the air, and this person will be more generous to you, because apparently we are machines, or partly machines. I hope we're just partly machines. I hope spirits immortal, but we don't know. But in fact, this machine is reacting to these things. Proceedings of the Royal Society. This was another interesting article published by Terence Barnard. He made a very interesting experiment, because the title says everything. High testosterone men reject low ultimatum gain offers. So now we know why some people accept it, some people not. It depends also on the level of testosterone. So he said, I get students of microeconomics. Why? Because if they study economics, it means that in this part of the brain connected with rational choice theory is working more. Otherwise they would study art or philosophy. It means they are obsessed with money, they study economics, they want money, so I want them. Secondly, I want just men. And third, I give this rule. You cannot share the money 50-50. Either you give 25 to the second player, or you offer 5. You have just two possibilities. He knew that no one would offer 25 because there's so much into money and maximizing profit. They wouldn't do it. That's what he wanted. He wanted all of them offering unfair proposals. In fact, that's what they did. They all offered $5 and 35 for me because it was $40 here. $40 game. 5 for you and the rest for me. Then it checked, it got saliva samples from their mouth, and it checked the level of testosterone. And the result exactly was this, was written in the title. I mean, people having 50% higher level of testosterone, they were those that were rejecting all the low offer, while those that were accepting, generally, you know, they had a lower offer of lower level of testosterone. Then the interesting thing is when I have this lecture in economics department, they're all asking me about how can I check the saliva sample of the people, which because I'm more a scientist, so I don't care about these practical things, you know. I'm interested in knowing the truth. I don't know with basically about these things, but they are interested in making money. So well, how can I know the level of testosterone of people? When I expect they reject, I say, of course, you can watch many things. You can watch the shape of the face, yes, for instance. If it's square jaw, then they have a higher level of testosterone, or a lot of hair, or just the ring finger, longer than index finger, means a lot of testosterone. Otherwise, index finger longer. Then I tell them these things. I'm not much interested in this, but they are very happy when I tell them this. You know, then they watch hands of people. To see if they accept low offer or not. and then what? Okay, this is always the same debate after. You know, probably there's a different definition of rationality. I mean, what people care really is not money, it's social status. If you can get the social status by punishing someone that you have in front of you, then money is totally irrelevant because you punish this person in a different way. 2008, the question now is, okay, now we know about men. What about women? Yeah, because testosterone. And so there were other experiments. This is quite interesting. This was made by a team. You can see there were also nice ladies making this experiment. They were probably interested in knowing what happened. And they discovered, for instance, that serotonin is quite important in this situation. So if someone has a low level of serotonin, we reject unfair offer more often. So if you artificially lower this level, you may have this effect. If you artificially make it higher, you have a different effect. This is something that my grandmother knew without making any research. When she wanted a favor from someone, she was making a good meal, and then these people would become, you know. So we may have it from popular words. But now, at least we have some scheme. So conclusion, yes? Conclusion is this. Probably all of course, we are like this because of evolution. Because for 4 million evolution, some people could reproduce and other could not. Basically, we need some level of egoism in order to survive and reproduce individuals. I'm talking about individuals, we need some level of egoism, but on the other hand, we are social beings, so we need other people, we need to deal with other people, so if we exaggerate with this egoism, we are just marginalized, so we cannot reproduce and with our genes. And that's why the evolution looks as we know, because otherwise, it counterfactuals, it would look like this, but it doesn't look like this. Thank you. Is there any question?
Yes.
So you don't moderate? I don't know.
Do you have this question to?
Everybody need to adjust first. That was a lot of information in such a short time.
More or less 70% or 60% so certainty about this result.
Yes.
And so do you
yes.
Something about this?
The thing is this, is that As I said, human beings can be studied with mathematical means, but of course it's all about probabilities. We never have certainty here. We never have certainty. The thing is that someone said, all right, much depends on the way the game is done. As I said, the response is more or less the same. Yes, everywhere. Here you saw that high testosterone was about 7 people on 20.
There are 7 people in a
group. Yes, he's a small boy. But this was repeated many times all around the world, I mean the general ultimatum game. As I said, the response it was never surprising. It was more or less like this everywhere. But one thing is interesting is this, one possible, because this question is very important, yes, because we are discussing all the time about this empirical test, you know, can we trust it after all people change. Someone said, but what if we make an experiment, we don't offer $10, but $10 million. And the offer is $1 million for you and $9 for me. Then probably the answer would be different, because this $1 million may change your life. So even if you think, okay, he's a bastard, is a fucker, but I get this $1 million. Yes, this is something that can be a possible response. So they try to make the experiment in Indonesia. Then they say, okay, let's go to Indonesia. They earn like $100 per month, and we make this experiment with a lot of money. Something that, you know, well, we not change their life, but actually, you know, if we play with a few $100s, and they will respond the same way. So even if this amount of money was a lot for them, if you offer them like $200, they will say no, because you're too much egoist. So it seems that these ethical rules, we never made the experiment with $1 million, by the way, so we don't know this. But the thing is, like, even with us, the amount of money is pretty important, people tend to reject it. Another interesting thing is, but what if the life of player two depends on this decision? Because why people accept now, for instance, in business, that the top manager of the company gets $1 million per month and the worker $1,000 per month. This is not just 1-9, it's 1,001. This is what happened in big corporations. Yes? Why people accept this? Because their life depends on this $1,000. It's not just, you know, I punish him and then I die. You know, it's like, okay, it's my life, I have to accept it. So in concrete life, we may have situations in which people actually accept a very low offer, but when their life depends on this.
It depends on everybody's needs, because everybody has a different needs and a different lifestyle, so it's...
Yes, it depends on needs. So we know that there is such mechanism inside, but sometimes it depends on the situation. If you think about strides, what people do is exactly this. It's like, I don't work today, I don't get paid today, but the owner of the stockholders will lose more money than me, and so I will try. This is called coalition game. It's a game studied also inside the... So of course, reality, this is a model, this is an abstract model that can help you to, is an ideal type. It can help you to understand some situation, because it simplifies the situation. But of course, reality is much more complex. You may have situations, as I said, when you accept a rate,
yes,
of
I understood this, but my question was about this neuroscience, about these researchers.
Yes, they're making
about these researchers.
Yes, they're making this with, as you see, with...
For example, in Berlin, there are this charity hospital with Dr. Heines, doing something similar like this with fMRI, and so in the satiety with these researchers are more or less 70% with the brain researchers, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yes,
so,
yes.
So it is quite 50%, it is quite...
Yes, here the results were much more clear, but I agree with you that the sample of people is very low, because if you do it with 20 people, mm-hmm. 20, to do it with 1,000 people would cost a lot of money. Maybe in the future they will do it, or with a bigger sample of people. Here they are doing this with a very small amount of people. But why these research are published in prestigious journals like Science? Because for pragmatic people, it's better to have a partial truth than nothing. No, the rational choice theory. It's not like either I know the perfect truth, certain, and so on, or nothing. No, I'm okay with some type of knowledge because I have to decide. These people, military people, have to decide. Businessmen have to decide. So I can see that they don't care about certainty and perfection. That's why this research is quite popular anyway. Even if I agree with you that you may find different results.
Yeah, I have a question. You talked about the motto. Game theory is for you a motto. I don't know, what do you think? You are historian of ideas. You have two magazines in Italy. Even here, you invite Gianni Vattimo to write in your magazine. I found in the dictionary for the history of ideas, this American dictionary one. The notion game theory in the dictionary for the history of ideas, in the motto of Love Choice, history of ideas.
Yes.
Why this notion is in this dictionary?
Yes.
It is an idea, game theory, of the motto for you. Huh?
Yes,
this is a
yes,
question.
Yes.
What do you think about this?
Okay.
This
for non mathematicians, and I'm not a mathematician, I'm a bit into mathematics, I wrote my master thesis on statistical models, but I'm not a mathematician, is a bit secondary or is a bit irrelevant if this is expressed in mathematical form or literary form. If we focus on new mathematical game theory, of course it started much before Blaise Pascal or von Neumann. It started much before this. For instance, but it's not just me saying that. Even John Nash, who is a mathematician, he said, well, if I had to decide where game theory started, I would say Machiavelli. Niccolo Machiavelli, because he was studying all these political games inside the Vatican court, and they were playing games with power, and he was applying models that are very similar to those developed by von Neumann, but just not with formulas or in a linguistic way. So John Nash would say Machiavelli, but of course we could go back to the Greece, to the Greeks. Okay, we can find Plato, for instance, talking about this aspect. We're talking about war, for instance. The example was if you have a battle, yeah. The example was this: if you have a battle, a soldier has no interest to take part in the battle because if his army is going to win anyway, there's no sense to risk your own life. If your army is going to lose, there's no sense to take part in the battle, so it's irrational to fight anyway. But if each soldier thinks this way, what is rational for an individual is not rational for in the interactive game. So that's why game theory is about interactive games. So if everybody thinks this way, nobody would fight and you would always lose any battle. So that's why actually all armies on the world, they implement a different system in order to give a motivation in this payoffs matrix for the soldier to be there. And the motivation is always the same. Is put the soldiers there, then you put an elite behind them that kills them. Each time they turn and they are afraid to go back, you kill them. Italians had carabinieri shooting at people when they were going back. Germans probably had another elite corps that were shooting other Germans. Pretend killed, I don't know, 20,000 French people that were not fighting. So this is the thing that was always applied in a war. So forget Hollywood movies about war with heroes. They are fighting because they have no choice. Either they die fighting the enemies or they die killed by their own elite corps, their own soldiers. And this is what I always applied during all history. In fact, democracy was created this way, because you know what the Hoplitic phantom was based on this principle. Democratic countries have bigger armies. But by using normal citizens, but normal citizens are afraid of war because they are not warriors. Aristocrats are more used to fight wars. So they were organized the army this way, that each soldier had behind him a sword in his back. So he couldn't go back because he would die. And they were marching, so there were 1,000 people marching because they would die if they just stopped. And inventing this system, this is game theory. This was used by Alexander the Great to win wars or by other great strategists. So yes, of course it's an idea that goes back, and this idea changed all the history because you know, we wouldn't have democracy, we would just have aristocracy if we wouldn't have this system to convince non-soldiers to fight against soldiers.
And this is then Unity's idea.